Is this on? Can you hear me? Okay. Good evening, everyone. My name is Nick, and I just wanted to start off by thanking Wimala for leading us in meditation tonight, and for Tess and Rebecca for inviting me to talk with you all today, and for you all for being a part of this community and coming to meditation tonight. My welcome back to Blue Lotus has been very warm, and it's really a joy to be a part of this community once again. And tonight, I would just like to share my story of my spiritual journey with Blue Lotus and share my thoughts on how we can use gratitude as our refuge. So every time we do chanting here, we start with the chant that translates into, I take refuge in the Buddha, I take refuge in the Dhamma, and I take refuge in the Sangha. And we repeat this three times. But what exactly is a refuge? And what does it mean to take refuge in this triple gem? So I feel like my spiritual journey is really kind of largely defined by experiencing this for myself and really what it all means. So let's start at the beginning. My spiritual journey was beginning more or less in my early 20s, about like 10 years ago. I was fresh out of college and challenged with beginning a career. I was spiritually aimless, having abandoned my religious upbringing, and I had been experiencing the falling apart of multiple close friendships. So, very dramatic beginning. I was a distraught young adult. But I felt very alone and poorly equipped to manage these issues in my life. As everybody has issues in their life, I didn't know what to do with mine. What I felt like I needed was some stability and confidence in my life, but I didn't know where to find that. So what was I to do? What ended up happening was I turned to self-medicating myself with substances to get by, and I carried on this way for several years, unaware of my increasing dependency on them to manage my growing anxiety and uncertainty with what to do in life. So time continues on, and one day I find myself in a bookstore looking for nothing in particular, and pulled out and just sitting on top of one shelf was the book Mindfulness in Plain English by Bhante G. You might know this book, and it's a pretty popular introduction to Buddhist thought in the West here. And it might even be in the bookstore, the gift shop, I don't know. So yeah, this was my introduction to Buddhism, and I felt like the ideas were really drawing me in, and I could feel some hope for myself in this direction for kind of directing myself and what to do in life. So I read through it and began applying what I learned. But with starting a new practice, it always takes some time and some guidance to really make it a part of your life. So it's a slow start. And then a few years later after that, in 2019, I moved here to Woodstock, and I was there to start a new job and to move closer to my partner, who was living in Chicago at the time. We wanted to be closer together, and I was in need of a change in my life. So, because the path I was kind of walking on wasn't very stable for me, so I kind of took a leap of faith, moved from Michigan to here, and wanted to just start something new. And sure enough, it wasn't long after I moved that I saw Blue Lotus was just around the corner from my new apartment on Woodstock Square here, and I was really excited about the coincidence of my new neighbor being a Buddhist temple, which is something that I was, you know, just get interested in. So I jumped on the opportunity to learn as much as I could about the practice and start attending meditation regularly here. So I was really happy with the time I was spending at the temple, and even though my life was still challenging me, I felt like I was finally starting to develop skills to manage my emotional distress and cope with the friendships I had lost and all of these things. And this was the first sign to me that there was value in this practice and my first taste of refuge walking along the path. After about a year of living in Woodstock, the COVID pandemic began. Everyone here was divided from their friends, family, and community. And early on in the pandemic, my partner and I decided to move out of town and return back to Michigan to be closer to family and kind of have that be our social network for the duration of the pandemic, however long that may be. And I was really sad to have to leave Woodstock and leave Blue Lotus behind me, but I was determined to make use of what time I did have here and continue that practice of meditation and mindfulness throughout my life. So even though I wasn't here, I could still keep that with me. So as we all know, the pandemic was a really challenging time for everyone. Our collective mental health took a huge hit from this world event, and for me, it was really amplifying my anxiety, depression, and dependency on substances to regulate my emotions. And eventually, I felt a tipping point was reached where using these substances no longer offered me any relief, and instead they began exacerbating all of these things. So a pretty common result of what happens from that. And I could feel just how unstable my mind had really been becoming over the years of substance use, kind of masking my deep-rooted issues and emotional distress. I didn't have any other outlet. And at this point in my practice, I had known about the precepts, but I hadn't taken the vow to fully take the precepts. I had just known about them, and it was something you think like, oh, I should do that. I should apply these, and one day I'll get there, right? So they're always in our mind there. I knew I had this deep attachment in me that I needed to sort out, and I was caught in this loop of knowing that, you know, if I use a substance, I'm not going to meditate that day. And if I don't meditate that day, I'm not going to develop any more insight into solving this problem. So it's just this loop that I was in. But I did know that the cycle had to stop, and I had to take refuge in something to break that habit pattern. So this was a major point of realization for me in what it means to take refuge in the path. I had to trust that I could overcome my growing dependency and that I could uncover the roots of my issues. It was not impossible. I had to abandon my failing coping mechanisms and bravely put my faith and my energy into the Dhamma, even though I knew it would be a painful change. It took many attempts and failures to break my substance use habits, but I can happily say that it eventually worked, and I've been sober for almost 2 years now, and I feel so much gratitude for the Buddhist teachings for helping me along the way. I needed some guidance in my life, and this is what the Dhamma provided for me. When we take refuge in the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha, we are acknowledging the potential within ourselves to change the habit patterns of our mind. We see that if the Buddha can do it, so can I. I just have to keep trying. So the last thing I would like to kind of share with everyone is how now I understand how powerful gratitude can be as a refuge. Because, you know, everyone here has challenges and losses in their life that we have to deal with. It's unavoidable. And lately for me, some of the things that I'm concerned about is just the kind of anticipatory grief of my parents getting older and some loneliness that I feel after my engagement ended a couple years ago. And even though these cause me some emotional distress when I think about them, I feel like my practice has given me the tools to manage that and stay grateful for what I do have. We know that what you focus your mind on will grow, and luckily we have some agency in this. The cultivation of concentration through meditation is one of the great fruits of our practice. And in these moments of distress, when these thoughts or situations arise that bother us, we can experience firsthand how gratitude can help. So now when I feel anxiety arising, I have the chance to be mindful. It's a reminder for me. I can think about this. I could either get lost in the negativity, and the worries, or the stories that I tell myself and get swept up in those feelings for who knows how long. Or I can take a moment to notice them, acknowledge these thoughts, and treat them as a friend. These are the things that I'm worried about, but they don't have to control me. It's these times where I'm mindful and I can view my thoughts and feelings in this way that I have space to begin practicing gratitude, instead of being swept away in these emotional thoughts. I like to think of all the ways in which I am grateful for what I have in this present moment and all the things I can be grateful for about my past experiences. So, for example, when I'm worrying about my parents getting older, I can be grateful instead for everything they've done for me and make sure I spend time with them, appreciating the present moment with them. When I feel sad about the end of my relationship, I can instead be grateful for the experiences I had, the lessons I learned about cultivating good relationships, and being grateful that I'm not experiencing the issues that would have happened had that relationship stayed together. Now, what I'm not suggesting is that you just simply get over the challenges in your life by pretending to be grateful for the bad instead. We all know it's not that simple. But given enough time and distance from these situations, I think there's a lot of room to heal from those experiences and find something to be grateful for in them after you've weathered the worst of it. So, for example, yeah, when my fiance called off my wedding, I was really shocked, I was confused, I was heartbroken, all these things. I felt so much of my life had been shattered and wasted, and was really lonely as a result. It was shameful to tell people about it. You know, it's not fun. And I had to move forward along a new path, one I hadn't chosen for myself. But I had to choose how I wanted to walk that path. It's been 2 years now, and I'm so much better for it, and I can feel so much gratitude for my partner that was brave enough to admit that our relationship wasn't working out, and something I didn't want to admit at the time. I'm grateful for the time we shared and the friendship that we still have today, and what felt like one of the most painful losses at the time is now something I look back on with so much gratitude. It's funny just how the passing of time and walking a new path can change your perspective on something. So the next time I encounter a great loss or experience pain, I can try to use this understanding to remind myself, I may be grateful for this experience one day too, even if I don't feel it right now. This here is the value of gratitude as a refuge to me. I could forever hold on to these losses or worries and let them define my life, or I could choose to find a way to be grateful for it. Neither choice changes what happened, but I can change how I let myself be a part in that story. I do not have to dwell in negativity or feed its growth. I can find peace in the present moment and know that this awareness and gratitude will help me appreciate today and be better prepared for the challenges of tomorrow. So the really fun thing I think about gratitude is the more you think about it, you notice just how long the list can go. You can go on forever, really. It's a bottomless well, and it's always refreshing to drink from. So I could be thankful for my apartment, for having a place to live and be safe, my current good health. I can be thankful for having a career that I enjoy that pays my bills, my friends around the world that I get to be in touch with. The list goes on and on and on. And as you meditate and choose gratitude as kind of your intention for that meditation, you can go the entire time. There's no limit to the things you can find to be grateful for. So, a refuge is there when we need it, as long as we make the effort to turn to it. Gratitude is my favorite refuge in this case. And when we take refuge in the chanting, what does it mean for you? For me, when I take refuge in the Buddha, I'm empowered by my own volition to do what is healthy for me, knowing that I too can progress on this path. I have the power to abandon behaviors that are unhealthy for me. When I take refuge in the Dhamma, I know that there is a source of knowledge and experience that I can learn from to help me. The teachings we receive here will continue to apply in new ways in our life as it continues on as well. And when I take refuge in the Sangha, I experience gratitude for all the people that have helped this place be what it is today. Their good merits have been shared with me, and I'm honored to help continue its growth. So these are my refuges, and I hope you find something of value in my story and thank you for coming today to listen. So if anyone has any comments or questions, feel free to raise your hand. But yeah, thank you for listening. Great. Yeah. Thank you very much. I'm happy to hear it. And I hope your journey's going well. Yeah, one of my favorite things about just hearing lay Dharma talks is just the relatability of everybody's story with one another. There's so many similarities we share in life that, you know, we don't always just like have our heart on our sleeve or our story ready, open to share. But yeah, nights like these are a good time to realize how similar we really are. Yeah, thanks.